Hi, and welcome to part one of this three-part series to answer the question, how can child welfare professionals use the Black Foster Youth Handbook? And if you can see closely, there has been some definite changes from the last edition that was released back in September 29th. So there's quite a few changes here, and I'm so excited to explore that, as well as listening to some powerful thought leaders in part one of this three-part series that include Dr. Regina Gavin-Williams, DeAndre Robinson, and Liza Weidel. So without further ado, I'm sure you all have so many questions, and one of those questions for those of you that are new, it's probably, what is the Black Foster Youth Handbook? And so I'll go ahead and play this clip for you all to kind of get some background on what it is before we hop back in. All right, well, I hope you are settling in. You got your tea, you got your coffee or your beverage of choice, and maybe even a pen and pencil together, because, you know, you're gonna be dropping some gems, as we always do here on Soulful Liberation. So without further ado, make sure to share this out with those that you care about and you think that this would be great for them to learn how they can best support their young people. All right, let's go to the next clip.
What if the only way to move forward is to first take a look back? Foster care has always been a conflicted area. A constant battle between the well-being of young people and bank balance. Ángela outlines these two narratives with an explorative yet emotional approach. Ángela believes that the best way forward for foster children in the system is through a happy, healthy, and holistic path. She opens a window into her world with heartfelt honesty and integrity, whilst also maintaining an empirical basis by including official data and statistics. This intention of this book is not to only reflect the system, but the reader too, in a series of mirroring moments. Each chapter encourages the reader to trust in the direction they have been set upon with a series of informative anecdotes and supporting evidence. This book is deeply informative with a balance of shocking statistics and personal accounts. Advocating healing of indoctrinated narratives and focusing on the turning point, Ángela is a beacon of hope for the establishment and beyond. Although regarding a difficult situation with an evaluative and encompassing approach, the overtones of Ángela writing is one that, with the utmost respect, distinguishes elements of progression and hope for the future. It looks back at history with love and adoration, taking on board the lessons that will stand with us today and make communities stronger. The Black Foster Youth Handbook, available on Amazon and our official website. Order now.
So before I get into the actual model of the book, I just want to share some of the changes. So as of January 5th, 2021, there has been an added prologue by Dr. Regina Gavin-Williams, which you will be hearing from her closer to later on in the event. And I forgot what this is called, the binding of the book side used to have an all black area, and now it's taken off basically because it kept moving and that was very frustrating as far as long term. So I just completely took off the black, and now it's just the blue, the same color as the front and the back cover. And on the inside, which we're going to get into later on, you will see that after the intro, the bulk of the intro before the Still Here poem, there is the real success model and an actual visual. And I felt like that was very needed because, you know, I do go in depth about what the real success model is in the book. However, you weren't able to see an actual visual of what that looks like. So I kind of broke it down and added some, you know, information around what exactly it is and how we can apply that. All throughout the book, as many of you know, it's broken into four phases. So it's REAL, root, envision, ascension, and liberation. And so essentially this is a journey towards liberation or soulful liberation for young people in foster care and anyone that gets to pick up this book. And you don't even have to be associated with foster care, but that is the premise that this book is written from, right? The lens that is written from as a young woman of color that experienced the foster care system and wanting to help others holistically heal and age out of foster care successfully and lead a life away from pain and into purpose and power. So I know our first person that wants to say a little something to you all about how this can be used. It's just a very quick little note. It is DeAndre Robinson. So we'll go ahead and start with you.
I want to talk about my friend Angela's book. First things first, I want to say that I am very, very proud of you for this book. This book is amazing. You're an amazing person from, like I said before, from when we worked together, you were the voice of the voiceless. So I am very, very proud of you for this book. And I think that everyone should read this book. So now the book in question is the Black Foster Youth Handbook. I read this book. I'm done with it. I love this book. I really do. I grew up in foster care, and I used to work for about 10 years for direct service with foster youth, either working in youth shelters or working at a national level with a nonprofit in Seaside, Oregon. And this book is amazing. There's not a lot of books out there for Black youth in foster care. And it doesn't break it down, like nothing break down how things should go, what you should do, give you that guidance. I had to learn this through a lot of hard lessons. I had to learn how to get through foster care, being foster care while Black. It's not the easiest thing. It can be challenging, especially if you don't know a lot of things. So in this book, Angie breaks down how you should go through foster care while being Black. And I think that everyone should definitely, at least go through and read this book, especially if you're Black and being in foster care. It breaks down like your rights and what you should do, how you can get things, what you should have when you age out and while you're in foster care. So this be a perfect book for anyone of color to read during foster care. I wish I had it. It would be easier for me. This is a beautiful book.
So thank you so much, DeAndre, for your words and just sharing some of your reflections and a piece of your story. I love your shirt. I would love to share now what I was talking about earlier, the real success model, which is here, and can't really see it because of the thing, but I kind of zoomed into the diagram piece. And so for those of you that have already started reading, you know that the triangle represents the inspiration from Maslow's hierarchy of needs, which for me actually goes a lot deeper in this particular diagram that I've created, because it actually is more connected to sacred geometry. And so this is also infused with African and indigenous spiritual systems. And that is what the chakra or energy centers or even arits are shown in the diagram, as well as a Black tree which represents multiple things, but we're going to keep it simple today and say that it represents a body of some sort. And that could be a system, that could be an individual, that could be a body, meaning a group of people. And it's this idea of taking someone, a system, or a group of people from root to what I call in the book soulful liberation. And so root is really recognizing what is this aspect of where you've come from and what are these ideas, thoughts, beliefs, that patterns that you are carrying with you or the system is carrying with it, right? And a lot of times when we think about rooting, there's this idea of, you know, the roots are all bad, let's discard them. And the truth is, that is only part of how, you know, only one way that you can handle the situation. Because when you think of a plant and you're thinking about the roots of a plant, it really is holistic, right? You have to check what is really needed for this plant to bloom, to blossom. And so that could mean that it needs more water. Maybe it needs more sunlight. Maybe it needs less sunlight. Maybe it needs better soil. You know, maybe the soil isn't fertile enough, you know, needs more nurturing, no, more love, more TLC. And so it's really shifting this idea of just throwing the whole roots away, but instead, how can we actually not completely disregard the roots of where we come from? Specifically, if we're a young person in foster care, you know, that could be rooted in neglect, in abuse, in pain, in struggle, in so many different things. And so we want to be very focused on what does that really mean for us and how can we change that narrative. So that is the first phase of the book. We get our toes wet a little bit on like, where are we right now? You know, what has been the history of who we are, our lineage? And then we move into envision. How do we want to move forward? This idea of dreaming big and really expanding the way you view life and the way you view love and the way you view healing, and fun and excitement and fulfillment. And, you know, just really taking the time to really get to know, like, who are you? You know, who do you want to become? And ascension is really taking steps forward into that, looking at your support systems and the relationships that we have really make or break that situation, and really make or break our success. A lot of times we don't have the right people that are around us because we never truly understood what a healthy relationship even is. And therefore, we don't have a healthy relationship with ourselves, and it's reflected in the other relationships that we have with everyone around us. Whether that is poor boundaries, whether that is, you know, allowing people to do things to you that you would never do to them and explaining it away. And yes, we should have grace and yes, we should forgive. However, we also at the forefront need to love ourselves and be able to protect ourselves. Self-preservation is key. Otherwise, you know, you can't give from an empty cup. So really looking at our habits, looking at our goals, looking at our support systems and making sure that moving forward, you know, we are in alignment to who we say we want to be and producing the fruits from the plant that we said we want to grow. And that could be within ourselves, that could be a system, and that could be a group of people. And last but not least, liberation, or what I call soulful liberation. And that is really rooting in your purpose and building a legacy that you are proud of, not even after you pass, but now you're proud of now that you're able to create now, being a living legacy and being clear on, you know, what is fun and let me just explore that. Like, let me just take off this cast of pain and trauma and hurt all the time to now shifting into purpose and power. So I hope that that clears a lot of things and it makes it very clear as to what the real success model is. Without further ado, I will be introducing Mrs. Eliza Weidel, and she's going to give her take as a former Garden Ad Litem and now the CEO of FRS Communications.
Hello, my name is Liza Weidel, and I am the Chief Encouragement Officer for my company called FRS Communications. We focus on content strategy and social media, as well as helping people get the word out about their businesses. I'm also an author. I wrote the book, The Truth About Parenting, Navigating the Elementary Years. This was written when my boys were in elementary. Since that point, we became foster parents, and then I became a guardian ad litem. And that's why I'm here today, is to talk a little bit about my niece's book, The Black Foster Youth Handbook. I'm so excited about this book and the way that it was written, and what a tremendous resource it will be for not only Black foster youth, but also for guardian ad litems, as well as foster parents and others who are youth advocates. You know, my journey from parent to foster mom to guardian ad litem was taken in very small steps. Along the way, I had to learn to let go of what I thought was best according to my background, to doing what was in the best interest of a child according to their unique skills and abilities. Becoming a guardian ad litem is not for the faint of heart. The training involves learning about the court system and understanding the intricacies of the foster care system, as well as the role of the guardian ad litem and how to write court reports. After the weeks of training, I was appointed by a judge to investigate the needs of a child. And almost before I could pull out from the swearing-in ceremony, I received a phone call telling me that I had been assigned a child. Oh boy, I had to take some deep breaths because I didn't think I was ready. And you know, the truth is no one's ever really ready to become a guardian ad litem. I had to realize that, you know, through my experiences with the PTA, and then I went on Mom Congress, and then the work that I've done in the area, I probably could at least make a good effort and work really hard with the family and certainly with a child to understand what was going on and to understand how to best advocate. And probably the most important thing I had was the time and the heart for the work at hand. You know, in meeting the foster youth, I quickly learned that it wasn't about giving the child more stuff. You know, jackets get lost and toys get broken and, you know, bikes will get flat tires and all the stuff in the world will never help a person realize their full potential. What foster youth really need is a pathway through the chaos that has become their life, to finding their voice, to understanding who they are, apart from their background and their current circumstances. And Angela's book really can help with that. It is a framework. It's a journal. The youth can write in it after each lesson. It's also a wonderful book for guardian ad litems to understand from a youth perspective what's going on. You know, one of the hardest jobs for a guardian ad litem is earning the trust of a foster youth. You know, for me, I pretty much trust people to be who they say they are until they break that trust. And that's because I had adults when I was little that I could trust to give me the things that I needed. I may have wanted more stuff, but I always got what I needed. But that's not what's true for the foster youth. And they just have a hard time trusting people. And, you know, and from the moment they're placed into foster care, there's like this army of people who come in, and it's confusing the roles and who's supposed to do what and when and how often. And that's why it's important as a guardian ad litem to show up. And so I just kept showing up, and I was on time and actively engaged in the foster youth life. You know, the other thing that's important is not to expect the foster youth to be happy to see you or to maybe even like you. You know, that comes in time. And this book really helps describe some of those experiences and feelings. And the most important thing to realize as a guardian is it's not about me. Not at all about me. I had to make really sure that I kept my focus on the foster youth and just really realizing how different life was for them. And as Angela points out in her book, just to make really sure that you don't tell anyone that you are their child's, that child's guardian ad litem. You know, it's a point that should really be driven home in the guardian ad litem training, and somehow that just gets lost. If I would meet with a foster youth outside their home, I would always describe that I am a friend of the family, you know, and as I got closer, I became known as the aunt because I would show up and I would take pictures and do my best to help them capture happy moments in their life. And I really appreciated in Angela's book, she speaks to living in the moment and capturing those memories. And that's in lesson two. And you just have to really make sure that you're helping a youth through those times. Angela's lesson number six on Black history is still relevant today, is one that I wished I could have read when I was a foster mom. You know, she said it best, foster care is one of these systems that in many ways is still continuing to carry out institutional racism. You know, it seemed crazy to me that when I became a foster mom, I was only able to have a child in our home who looked like me. When I asked about having a Black child move in with us who seemed from an age, ability, and need, I was told no, because I wouldn't know how to style her hair. And for me, I thought there's so much more to a child's heritage and background than being able to style her hair. Plus, I knew I had a few friends who could have helped out. And I loved that Angela speaks to this in lesson 24. She says, your hair is your crown. And she really speaks to this, the differences and how important hair can be. And really, she even gets some tips and points towards some YouTube videos that could help as well. I am so glad that Angela wrote this book from her perspective and titled it the way that she did. She doesn't shy away from the tough topics. She allows space for the foster youth to write in. And let's see if I can find a good section where you can see that. So here's right here, you can probably see just a little bit where she allows some space for to write in. And I can imagine that when someone has this book, you know, it won't be finished in a weekend or even in a month. It's meant to go be gone through slowly and to go through time and time again. Angela's book helps youth dream not just big, but even bigger. You know, and she helps see that poverty is not a destination. In lesson 48, she speaks to how important financial literacy is, and there's some great steps in there, and guardians and foster parents really need to take note of that. You know, foster youth can really choose who, what, why, and where they want to go in life. And it's, this book really helps a youth kind of take charge of that destiny. This book also includes some poems, and I am so tickled that Angela sent me this poem called Still Here. And if you'll indulge me just a moment, I'm going to read it. Let us never forget our roots, nor who we have become. Our origin is of stardust. Revolution is our legacy. United through bloodlines of royalty, I must profess, for our people will always rise seeking progress. Nothing can hush our pride or slow the stamina of our stride. Our heritage flows with gold and honey from lands of wealth and jewels and money. Oh, how we've endured the trials of our past. Yet when all else is diminished, this resilience will last. For it is written in the cosmos eons beyond us, we are divine and without fear. And above all, we are still here. Angela, I am so proud of you. And I really have enjoyed this book and reading it. I've enjoyed knowing you since you were 16 years old. Can you believe it's been that long? And I have flowers here I wish that I could give to you, because it's got like a little sunflower, and I know that you love those. I wish you grace and peace and love in the new year, and thank you so much for inviting me to be a part of this. Bye.
And that is what's so incredible, because 16, since I've been 16, not a lot of people can say that, you know, been along for the ride since I was 16. A lot of people, you know, aren't here anymore in my life. So just wow. incredibly grateful for your support and you know, time and time again, you consistently showing up. Thank you. And so we're going to take a quick break. And after that, we will be listening to the last but not least speaker of today.
What if the only way to move forward is to first take a look back? Foster care has always been a conflicted area, a constant battle between the well-being of young people and bank balance. Ángela outlines these two narratives with an explorative yet emotional approach. Ángela believes that the best way forward for foster children in the system is through a happy, healthy, and holistic path. She opens a window into her world with heartfelt honesty and integrity, whilst also maintaining an empirical basis by including official data and statistics. This intention of this book is not to only reflect the system, but the reader too, in a series of mirroring moments. Each chapter encourages the reader to trust in the direction they have been set upon with a series of informative anecdotes and supporting evidence. This book is deeply informative with a balance of shocking statistics and personal accounts. Advocating healing of indoctrinated narratives and focusing on the turning point, Ángela is a beacon of hope for the establishment and beyond. Although regarding a difficult situation with an evaluative and encompassing approach, the overtones of Ángela's writing is one that, with the utmost respect, distinguishes elements of progression and hope for the future. It looks back at history with love and adoration, taking on board the lessons that will stand with us today and make communities stronger. The Black Foster Youth Handbook, available on Amazon and our official website. Order now.
So our next speaker is someone that has been a part of my life and has shared a lot of incredible, beautiful memories and moments with me and milestones. And I'm just so excited for you all to hear from her. She is the writer of the prologue for the Black Foster Youth Handbook, Dr. Regina Gavin Williams. She is a licensed clinician, scholar, and counselor educator. So I am so excited for you all to hear from her and to share, you know, a little bit of her reflections and how she believes that clinicians and others will be able to use this book to support the work that needs to be done in young people in foster care's life, as well as revolutionizing one of the systems that are impacted by white supremacy, which is foster care. So without further ado, Dr. Regina Gavin Williams.
Hello, everyone. My name is Dr. Regina Gavin Williams. I am a counselor educator, clinician, and scholar from North Carolina. And I just wanted to take a few moments to just give a testimony as to why the Black Foster Youth Handbook is an important tool for helping professionals such as me to have. This book was written by Mrs. Ángela Quijada-Banks, and it has been an amazing tool and resource for me to utilize as a clinician in my work with adolescents who are aging out of the foster care system. And so I just wanted to take a few moments to express, one, my gratitude for having such a practical tool to guide and inform my work. But I wanted to start just from the beginning of why I wish I had this tool when I first began my work with youth in foster care. So it was around 2013 when I met Ángela, and we began to work together. And during that time, I was a provisionally licensed clinician in the state of North Carolina, and just now getting a chance to work with youth who were in the foster care system. And during that time, it was a huge learning curve for me. There was a lot I just did not know as a clinician, as a person, all of the barriers that youth were facing who were involved in the child welfare system. I thought to myself, how naive it was for me to not understand the stories and the concerns that children and adolescents who were involved in the foster care system had at that time. And it was a lot of kind of searching for various tools in order to inform myself better. And it was extremely difficult during that time. What I knew was that I was a skilled clinician and that I had the tools to work with children and adolescents, and particularly those who were facing a lot of concerns. What I didn't know is all of the barriers and all of the different situations that children and adolescents were facing. And what I also knew during that time, I was in a doctoral program in counseling and counselor education. And, you know, we're taught in the doctoral program to really search and look for evidence-based practices that are really informing our work. So as I searched and searched through the counseling literature in my field, I recognized that there was a widely absent presence of what counselors could do to better support youth in foster care. A lot of the information I did find was in the social work literature, but being trained as a clinical mental health counselor with a counseling background as opposed to social work, I wanted to learn more about my particular field and what I could do to support. And one of the most valuable tools that I learned specifically from Ms. Quijada-Banks during that time was her own personal story. A lot of what I'm reading in this book, I'm remembering from the stories that she shared with me and the things that she was doing to overcome, to be resilient, to recognize the adversities in her life and to really reflect that in a place of overcoming and learning those tools to do so. So here I am as a clinician, I'm learning from the experiences of someone well beyond her years of what it really takes to truly capture the life lessons and tools and resources to better understand her positionality at the time as an adolescent aging out of the foster care system and what I could do to help her. And that ended up being one of the most valuable tools that I learned her in order to help support other youth that I was serving in that position. And so when I look back on that years later, and I see such a fruitful resource such as this that I wish I would have had during that time to really guide me in the work that I was doing as a helping professional to really serve with some evidence-based success tools that really allowed me to better understand where they were, educating me on all of the terminology at that time that I didn't understand, you know, the people that were in their lives that I didn't understand, and learning more about what those processes were like. I recognize after reading this, they're all in this book. It breaks down terminology, definitions, even legislation related to the child welfare system and foster care, and all of those tools and lessons that Ángela brings to the table that are helping to provide a source of support, a source of understanding, is something that helping professionals such as myself could use and understand in order to best support the people who are in foster care that we're serving. As a clinician, as a counselor, we're always taught to really engage the client or the individual with empathetic understanding. It's really difficult to engage in empathetic understanding if you're not recognizing the stories, the narrative of where the individuals you are serving and supporting are. To really recognize the intentionality behind what it means to truly understand. And I believe this resource is going to help helping professionals really recognize what it means to engage in empathetic understanding as it relates to supporting the youth that they serve in foster care. One of the real important tools that I think I got out of this book, this handbook was the model that Ángela uses, the real success model. And I really enjoy it because it really breaks down piece by piece what she would like individuals in care and also supportive adults to understand, kind of broken down. And I think that really gives it a pragmatic approach that I appreciate as a clinician and as a counselor educator. And it's really rooted in a theoretical framework, Maslow's hierarchy of needs. And so, you know, coming from my lens of understanding what it means to be able to create, practices out of evidence-based models, I really appreciate that Ángela took the time to create a model that really substantiates itself in a conceptual framework for helping professionals to abide by and to use as a guide, on top of also youth recognizing that. I also love, because I take a pragmatic approach as a counselor, the different activities. I could only imagine if I had this resource then, how I could sit down in my sessions and be able to truly speak to the reflections that she shares, but then also sitting down with the individuals I'm serving and going through one of the chapter exercises, doing a 72-hour challenge, or thinking about what it means for their own personal social development. It takes the guesswork out. To me, I am someone who likes to create structure in sessions, allowing for time for obviously the person to be able to share and reflect and for us to engage in what they would like to, but also leaving with some tools that they can work on in preparation for the next session. And I feel like this handbook allows me to do that. So even in my work as a clinician now, it's going to allow me to really work with the youth and have some exercises and tools and tips that we can work on both in session and between that is going to allow us to engage in conversation the next time we connect again. So to me, that's very important. Another tool that, you know, fellow counselors, helping professionals, you all could probably attest to is we like to have tangible resources that we can actually utilize. As much conferences as I attended, one of the things that I really get out of it and what I've learned from presenting at conferences is professionals want to leave with some actual tools, some activities, some tips that they could utilize in their work. And so now I can go to conferences, I can reference and cite this book, I can be able to go through these exercises to show some of the practical tools that they can utilize and then direct the helping professional to this particular resource to utilize. And so again, from what I've seen during that time in 2013 to now is I was able to truly utilize this source as a way for me to recognize and understand what some of those barriers, you know, in reality that are faced outside of reading articles. I'm reading a true story of someone who's lived it, but also I'm able to get some tips and tools that I could use to help them to better understand their stories and to help them reach success. So I do feel like this particular handbook really speaks from a holistic wellness perspective. And what I mean from that is, you know, Ángela really takes the time to recognize the support that a youth aging out of the foster care system needs in mind, body, and spirit to holistically feel well, to get over those perhaps traumatic experiences they faced and really recognize the direction they'd like to take to reach success. And that's a really important aspect that I needed to recognize in order to better support youth aging out of the foster care system. And I think she captures that very well. So when you read this book, you're going to be able to see how to support a young person aging out of foster care from a personal, social, or social emotional standpoint, even from a career development standpoint, and also from an academic development standpoint. So it doesn't just talk about, you know, learning the system and who's going to be there to support you and all of those things, but it also talks about issues of person to really recognize the essential being that you could tap into in spite of what you're going through. And so with these 50 plus tips, I'm telling you, it's something that I have not seen before in the literature that I've read, in the articles that I've written. This, to me, has come up as my number one resource at this point. And again, I wish I would have had it when I was writing my dissertation on a relatable topic, career and college readiness and adolescents aging out of foster care. I wish I would have had it during the work that I've done. And I feel like if you are out there and you are a helping professional and you're looking for a source, not only for Black foster youth, but all foster youth and helping them to reach that adult self-sufficiency that we talk about so much, then this is a great resource for you, regardless of what kind of discipline you come from. Again, I came from the counseling field, but I know that it could be very supportive in other fields as well. I know social work, but I'm sure that there are several other school counselors. This is a great tool for you. And, you know, I really just want to express the gratitude that I feel that this particular handbook exists. In sharing this with my colleagues who are very informed in the work as what I would say are some high-level scholars, tenured professors who've been studying this kind of topic for so many years, they are in awe of this resource because they recognize that it needed to exist, that these stories needed to be illuminated, and that these success tips are something that are pragmatic, they are something that is practical, and that it could be of use for so many individuals around the world. And you're getting it from someone who's lived it, who's experienced it, and who has advocated for the better support of youth who are aging out of foster care. And so we're not only talking about this from kind of like this micro level, but we're taking this to a macro level. Mrs. Quijada-Banks has really taken the time to study and to inform legislators and congressmen about the importance of reaching and helping to support the success for adolescents and for youth in the foster care system. And so you're going to get all of that within this source. So as someone who is engaged in the field, to another person, I would say if you're looking for that source, if you're looking for a way to really inform your work, then this is for you. And of course, for the young people who are living this every day, this source is definitely for you. I hope that it brings you as much knowledge and understanding and hope as it did for me and my colleagues who are reading it or have read it thus far. And I hope it's something that you would share with your other colleagues, because the more that we continue to inform the message about how important a resource like this exists, the more a young person will get the support that they need. And so thank you, Mrs. Quijada-Banks, for writing this book. Please pick yours up. And I hope that you help the youth who are aging out of the foster care system in your life holistically heal. And I think this resource will help to do that. Thank you.
Dr. Regina Gavin Williams, you are doing some incredible work. You know, I've known you since, you know, when you were back to Regina Gavin. And, you know, now we've added the doctor and the Williams, but I'm just so proud. I'm so grateful to have someone like you in my life. Just been, you know, an incredible journey, and, you know, let's keep it going of dismantling these systems and creating healing spaces. And I'm just so excited to see what we create moving forward. So for all of you that are still tuning in and here with us, thank you so much for joining us. This is part one of the three-part series, answering the question, how can, you know, child welfare professionals use the Black Foster Youth Handbook? And there's so much more in store, so I am so excited. There will be dates at the end of this program. If you want to be updated, then be sure to send me a message with your email. And lastly, you are now able to access a free copy, an ebook copy of the Black Foster Youth Handbook in color. Hello, because the paperback copy, unfortunately, is not in color. So you will be able to see it in color, ebook version for free on my website. You can also pay $9.99 on Amazon, but if you want to access it for free, then just head over to my website, www.blackfostercareyouthhandbook.com. For some reason, it wouldn't let me get Black Foster Youth Handbook, so I have to say Black Foster Care Youth Handbook. And this emphasis on the care, blackfostercareyouthhandbook.com to get your free ebook copy. So I'm so excited. And, you know, if you haven't picked up your copy of the Black Foster Youth Handbook, if you haven't reached out to a nonprofit organization to order this book in bulk to help our young people and help our supportive adults yet, please check out in your area who those organizations are, who those people are that need to be connected to this resource, because, you know, things that happen, like with the Capitol yesterday, we really, on January 6th yesterday, we want to be clear that we're not in any way perpetuating any kind of levels of white supremacy, racism, or anything like that, right? We want to be clear, we want to be informed, and we want to make solutions that are helpful to others and not just to a small group of people. So I'm so excited, and I'm so grateful for DeAndre. Thank you so much for your support from day one, from when we first met in Seaside, and as coworkers, and, you know, just been very supportive in this book. Aunt Liza, you've been incredible in helping me get the word out. So I'm just so grateful for you, of course, through every single layer and aspect of my life, you have came through. And my big sis, Dr. Regina Gavin Williams, so much love to you. And I can't wait till, you know, we keep showing up and seeing what the next chapter really looks like. So until next time, thank you all for joining us. Go and get your free copy, your ebook copy, if that's what you want. If you want a paperback, you can still go to the same website and purchase that there. There are bulk discounts available. So if you're interested in bulk discounts, then send me a message on Facebook or my email, mrs.mrs.banksofficial@gmail.com. That's my personal email. So hit me up there and, you know, continue your journey towards soulful liberation. Thank you so much. And till next time, peace. Here are the remaining dates for how child welfare professionals can use the Black Foster Youth Handbook. Thursday, January 7th, already passed. So Wednesday, February 3rd, Wednesday, February 24th, and both at 4 p.m. Eastern Time. See you there.